Hello, it's JP from WeWeb, and in this video we are going to see how to create this pulse animation using the CSS Animation Editor in WeWeb. A pulse animation can be useful to let users know that they have an unread message, a reminder, or a breaking news, for example. It will be a small video, but we are going to divide this in three steps. First, we are going to add or to create the layout. Then we are going to add the animation. And finally, we are going to put the components inside of a context. And in this case, we are going to put the pulse animation next to a button. So let's dive in. So this will be the animation that we are going to recreate. Let's see how it's built. So if we look at the layout panel, we see that we have a wrapper, and inside of it, we have two divs, pulse one and pulse two. If we look at the animation here, we can see that there is actually only one pulse or one round that is animated. So that will be pulse two, and pulse one is just there and doesn't move. So let me hide this and we'll start from scratch. Okay. So I'm going to add a new div. And this div will be called pulse. And I'm going to duplicate this twice, and the duplicated element will go inside of the first one. And let's rename that pulse one and pulse two. We're going to set a fixed dimension inside of the parent wrapper, and we're going to put 80 to a ratio of 1:1 so that it will always has a square ratio. And the size here doesn't really matter for now. We'll see at the end that we can change this very easily and only at one place. So I'm going to select both of the pulse one and pulse two. And you can select two elements. You can multi-select by pressing the shift key and selecting your elements. And if I go down to the position, property, I'm going to select the absolute positioning. So what this does, if I hover over the elements here, we can see that pulse one and pulse two are overlapped at one place. That is because when you set an element to absolute positioning, it will remove them from the flow, from the natural flow of the elements on the page, and they will be positioned relative to its direct parent. So now what we want to do is for the pulse one and pulse two to fill the parent. To do that, we are going to go to the sizing properties and input 100% and a fixed height of 100%. So now we see that pulse one and pulse two fill the parent. To see a bit more clearly, we're going to add some colors. So let's try this red. And we're going to add a radius of 999 so that it always remains around. Earlier, I said that you can put any size that you want, and if I try 30, for instance, we can see that the children here always resize to the parent size because they have a relative dimension made in percentages, and that is always relative in this case to the parent. Let me make it a bit bigger so that we can see what we are doing. And now the setup is pretty much done. We can go to the step two, that is adding animation to the second pulse. So let's head over to the animation section, and we have a bunch of properties. The duration is how long the animation will take to complete, and I'm going to change the transition. So the transition is the speed of the animation during the lifetime of the animation. That means the ease in out means that it will begin slow, then accelerate, and then end slow. We're going to add this effect, and that's pretty much it for the properties. You can refer to the user documentation to see what each of these properties does. And now if we open the keyframes property and open the editor, you can see that we have a new panel at the bottom of the screen with two markers already in place. These two markers that are already here are for the 0% and 100%. So the initial state and the end state. So what we want in our animation is that at the beginning, we're okay with the default state. So that will be 100% of the parent. But when we reach 100%, we want the pulse tool to be bigger and for its opacity to go down. So I'm going to select the 100% here. When we are inside of the keyframes editor, any modification that we make on the properties that we see on the styles panel will be applied to only this marker. So for instance, if I go down to the transform property, I'm going to go to the scale and input 1.6. So we see that it's getting bigger on the x-axis. I'm going to do the same on the y-axis. Notice that when you do that, when you modify a property, you can see that the name of the property becomes green, highlighted in green. So that means it's only defined inside of the animation section. The second property that we want to modify is the opacity. I'm going to bring it down to 0. And you have this play animation here. And if I try this, we can see that at 0%, it's 100% of the parent. And as we go toward 100%, it's getting bigger and it's fading. Oh, I guess that wraps up the animation. If I hit stop, let's have a quick look at the keyframe editor here. Basically, you can see every property that you modified. If I format it, we can see that at 0%, it's at the default state. We changed nothing on it. But at 100%, we had a transform modification and an opacity modification. You can also modify everything here, but you can do it fully with the interface directly. Okay, I guess that's it for the animation. Next, let's go to step 3, that is using this pulse animation in context. So I'm going to add a new wrapper, and inside of that wrapper, I'm going to add a button. Let's take out the pulse that we just created and place this inside of the same parent as the button. And what we want to do first is to make this pulse animation, this pulse component, way smaller. So let's try 20 pixels. And now, the same as the children, we want to position the pulse animation outside of the natural flow. So we are going to put an absolute positioning. And what we want is for the pulse animation to be at the far top right corner of the button. First, I'm going to bring the pulse component to the front. To do that, I can add a z-axis and I can just add a 1 value. So that way, the pulse animation is at the front of the button. And I'm going to add -8 pixels to the top and -8 pixels to the right. And that will be relative to the parent container. And if I hit preview, we have our nice pulse animation. And this pulse animation, well, you only want this pulse animation to be displayed when there is an actual notification. And what you can do to condition this display is having a condition on inside of the conditional rendering section. And you can bound this to a Boolean or any data that you want and check if there is indeed a notification to display. So we've seen how to create the structure of a pulse notification, and we added some animation to it, and we learned how to place it inside of a context. And I'll see you on the next one. Bye.